Most High God, Yahweh, Jehovah Nisi, Jehovah Jireh. Folks, we bless God for an opportunity to serve Him here in 2016. We also welcome you and welcome you back to our Bible study. My name is Clarence, and I'm pastor of United Body of Christ Church, which is our online ministry. And again, it's just an honor and a blessing that God would call us here in 2016 to serve Him as we've done in 2015. So it's wonderful to be the elect of God, to be a child or a son or a daughter of God in these, I would call, the last and final days. Amen. Just taking time out to acknowledge our Creator, to acknowledge the one who have bestowed His blessings and His generosity upon us. Eternal God, we thank You. What a wonderful God that we serve. He that have chosen us before we were ever born, that we would become sons and daughters of the Most High God. Father, it's not because we've done all that You have asked us to do that we've been able to come to this point in time, Lord. It's not because we've been so good or because we've been so righteous, but it's because of Your grace and Your mercy. It's because You chose us that we would be having our sins atoned for by the blood of the Lamb, the Lord Jesus Christ. And Father, even to this day, Your kindness is bestowed upon us from heaven. How You blessed our families, how You bless us, Lord, our neighbors. Father, You've opened up our eyes and You softened our hearts and You've unplugged our ears that we may hear and receive Your truth and that we may hear the voice of Jesus and another voice we won't follow. Father, because of that, we thank You. We thank You that You have given us a spirit of discernment, Lord, that we know the voice of God, that You have given us a spirit of discernment to where we're able to test the spirits that claim to come in Your name. Father, thank You. Thank You, Father, for when we've acted out or when we found ourselves rebellious. You didn't cast us away, Lord. But You stayed with us, Lord, and helped us to get through the demanding times, to help us to get through the weaknesses and the fears that would subtly sneak upon us, oh God. Father, You've helped us to get through every news article, every doctor's report, everything that would come against us, every weapon that had formed itself against us, Lord. You've gotten us through it, and we thank You, Lord. We thank You for being strong in the midst of our weakness. Thank You for how You kept our families and how You've kept us, Lord, how You've purified us and gave us, allowed us to seek Your face with sincere praises and prayers, Lord. Thank You, God. Now, Father, we pray that Your spirit be upon us, even as we go forth in this lesson, Lord, that we receive the edification of the truth which we are about to embark upon. Father, that there would be power and that You would be glorified, Lord. Father, thank You for the invitation to come and sup and to come and serve. Jesus, thank You for interceding and preparing a place for us. Thank You for making Your abode within us, Lord. All these things, Lord, how You've kept us and how You bless us, we thank You in the name of Jesus the Christ, our Lord and our Savior. In Jesus' name, great blessings be upon you, my Father, the God of Abraham, of Isaac, and of Jacob. He that is before, right now and hereafter, the eternal creator. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Hallelujah and glory to you, Lord. In Jesus' name. Again, folks, we welcome you back to our Bible study, our first recording our first broadcast here in 2016. Amen. And looking back, we would think that, you know, as a kid, me being a child, and, you know, if you tell me 2016, what the year would be like, and if I'm 8 or 9 years old back in the day, and people are telling me about 2010 and 2014, 2016, I'm thinking flying cars and everything, and we're not too far from there. It's like those things that we've heard about when we were children, we're actually living in this time now. And we bless God to be living in an age of Bible prophecy being fulfilled as well. Amen. I'm not going to hold you. We'll go right into the formality so we can get into the Bible study. If you don't have Bibles, again, today we're going forth in Judges chapter 10 and 11. If you don't have Bibles, whereas you can follow the lesson line per line, verse per verse, don't worry about it. We got you covered. You can go to our website at www.ubcchurch.org. Folks, once you get to our webpage, you'll look towards the top of the page and you'll see tabs that run underneath the banner. Once you identify the tabs, you'll be looking for the particular tab that says Online Bible. Once you see that, you'll click on it. It's going to bring up another web page. That web page has a field box in the center of it. You'll also see an arrow. And if you click that little arrow, it's going to bring up a menu. That menu was populated with the 66 books of the Bible, the King James edition. You'll also select Judges for today's lesson. And right beneath that, you'll select chapter number 10. And again, all that is necessary that you may follow us verse per verse. We're living in a time to where it's becoming more and more unpopular with the rest of the world to be a Christian or a believer and a follower of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Many laws are being adopted that enable the behavior of the world, even trying to indoctrinate our kids to this new world, if you will. And it's almost being to the point that the ordinances and the teachings of Jesus Christ have no play in this world. Those things that Jesus had taught, and as we follow and adhere to it, if we own businesses, we would be criminalized for adhering to the principles that our Lord and Savior had bestowed upon us, you know. And so, again, we're living in a world to where it's becoming unpopular. We can expect persecutions through the legal system first to try to combat our livelihood, and then eventually to try to take away our freedoms. It seems as though this is where we are headed. And we want to make sure that we get as much word as possible inside of us, because faith comes by hearing, and hearing comes by the word of God, and it's going to take our faith to get us through. We want to make sure that we're not taking in the wrong thing. People coming in the name of God, and then ultimately, when you start to pay attention to them, you find out which God they serve. Their God happens to be different from the God that we serve, being that we serve the God of Israel, the God of Abraham, of Isaac, and of Jacob. So we want to make sure that we hold true to the scriptures and that we eat as we're being served, but that we also check to make sure what it is that we are being served, because we're going to need to take the authentic, the word of life and the bread of life. We need to take this word and sow it into our hearts, because we're going to need it to get through the times that are here and that are to come. Amen. Those of you that require and desire prayer, Folks, we should all be praying. And in these days and times, part of our walk and the demonstration of our walk with God is prayer. And folks, we get weak. I don't care who it is. We are tested. We are tried. And it's like if we're not diligent, if we're not consistent, then that particular moment that we are tried, those things that we didn't fall for in the past, we end up falling for now. The pressure is turned up, and our faith is tested. Our commitment to God is tested. We have to make sure that we are constantly praying. This is why we are attacked in the area of distractions. You know, there are so many distractions that are upon us to keep us to have somewhat of a microwave prayer life. So when we go to bed, we're giving a real quick prayer. God, thank you for this day. Now I lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord my soul to keep. You know, and we're somewhat of a microwave prayer life. And because our prayer, we're almost text messaging God in a prayer life. And so what happens is when the storm comes around to try us, because we've had such a microwave walk with God, something real quick and instant, and there's no real substance there because it's microwaved, then we start falling for those things that we shouldn't fall for, tripping over things that we see coming, and we got a plan to get by it, but somehow we're led into it and we're falling for it. This is the area that we need to invest the more time, because it begins to fortify us. When our Lord and Savior was here, Jesus the Christ, the Mashiach, Yeshua the Mashiach, when he was here, and those things that was before him that Jesus would have had to go through, and we've seen a level of weakness displayed in him, you know, so much so that he asked his Father in heaven, you know, and during his prayer life, if it's possible that this cup could be removed from me. However, not my will, but your will be done. And the scripture says, during his prayer and even after his prayer, that he was strengthened. But it took for him to go through his prayer. It took for him to get down and to pray so that he would have the strength to go through those things that was before him. That's what we need to have in order to make it through the persecutions, in order to endure, in order to stay focused, to stay ready, to stay pure. We have to find our strength through prayer. And as we are encouraged and strengthened, we start to go through those things afterwards. So we want to make sure that we have more than a microwave walk with God and a microwave prayer life. And again, I define microwave being something that's instant, without substance, but instant. We want to make sure that we take that time and invest it. And not just for the sake of ourselves, but for the sake of others that may be going through something. Your neighbors, your family, your families, your co-workers. Someone may be going through something. And you catch wind of whatever it is that's troubling them. You hit your knees and you spend some time talking to God about it. This is who we are and this is what we do, not just for our sake, but for the sake of others, especially those of our brothers and sisters. This ministry, we believe in standing with you in prayer. Believing that you are praying as well as we're praying for you. If you want us to pray with you, please, you can go to our website, hit the prayer request tab. It'll bring up another web page that will allow you to fill out some confidential information like your name, your email address, You'll check a box if you want your name to appear on our prayer list and then also the reason for your petition. Hit the submit button. My wife and I will receive it. We'll read through it and make sure that which you are asking us to stand with you in agreement of, that it lines up with the Word of God. And my wife and I will go and hit our knees and be in a prayer closet concerning those matters that come that has come before you. We try to cast them before the throne of God. Now, let me also say this. Those of you that are praying for somebody, maybe financially, for a level of substance that whoever you're praying for, whatever substance that they lack, if it's in your power to give to them, to cover them in this moment of need or in this time of lack, if it's in your power, then we shouldn't, or you shouldn't be praying to God that he would bless them so that they can have that which have been omitted from them. If it's in your power, if they're hungry or if they need money for their lights, if you catch wind of this, that their furnace has broken down or their car, they were stranded on the highway and come to find out they need a car battery, whatever the deal is, if it's in your power to help them without looking for anything in return, if it's in your power to help them, then by all means, instead of a prayer, it should be a praise to God for the opportunity given to you to be able to help somebody, whereas it was in your power to do so. This is who we are. This is how we are. This is how our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ was, is, and will be always. We mimic his ways. So those things that are in our power to do, it's not that we need to hit our knees. We just need to open up our mouths and give God the praise for the opportunity to glorify him in our giving and our helping of others. Amen. So also those on our prayer list, for the month of January, Sister Fran Dunham, Jasmine Kay for the month of December, Ashley Adams, Junelle, and I have a problem with this last name, Paisami, Kasim Tabin, and Robin Ann Morris, Timothy Bradshaw, Joseph Habijams, Bonnie Harf, and Fran Dunham again. Amen. So forgive me, folks, if I pronounce your name right, or I'm sorry if I pronounce your name wrong, but the Lord knows who I'm talking about when I speak to him concerning you. Amen. Last but not least, if you are not saved, please get saved. I mean, there's times that we think the bottom of society is just going to drop out, and then there's other times that it just seemed that that whatever was on the horizon has been delayed. And so now we got some more time, and in this time we begin to sigh, but and we begin to plan ahead. The problem with planning ahead is it has nothing to do with our salvation. It has to do with a vacation or what we can do to get by this week or what we can do to get by next week. Once we become a little complacent because the danger level has subsided, instead of having that frequent and constant state of readiness, once danger seems to have gone by, all of a sudden we get a little relaxed and the preparation has stopped. And so we think we got a little bit more time to do what we want to do and be how we want to be. The sense of urgency has been placed to the side. And then all of a sudden our commitment to the kingdom of God has been placed on hold. And I'm telling you that in a time of peace, that's the time that you prepare. It's within the time of peace that we prepare for war. Amen. It's in a time of peace that we start cleaning our house and allowing God to come in and to get to know him. Walk with him while we can before it becomes hard and before it becomes illegal to walk with him. Get used to walking with him in good days so we'll know how to stand with him in bad days. Now is the time for you to prepare. Now is the time for you to commit. Now is the time for you to repent. Not when things are bad, but if God avails us peace, then it's within this time of peace that we go to the source of peace and that we prepare to stay in peace. Amen. So you want to read, to do this, you commit your life. You commit, you receive the gift of salvation that the Father is offering through his only begotten Son, Jesus Christ. You call upon the name of the Lord so that he can bring you into salvation. You'll read Romans 10 and 9, Romans 10 and 10, 11, 12, and 13. Also, you want to read Acts chapter 2, verses 36, 37, and 38. It talks about repentance, understanding that God has made Jesus the Christ, the very one that we have been against and crucified. He has made him to be the cornerstone, the headstone, if you will. And it is within Jesus where we have our salvation. So we repent, we are baptized so that we can receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is significant because in order to enter into the kingdom of God, our transformation comes now. You don't have the power to transform yourself. It takes the works of the Holy Spirit. And so the Holy Spirit comes, we get the gift of the Holy Spirit. We begin to listen to the Spirit. The Spirit tells us to go pray. We get up and we go pray. The Spirit tells us to turn that off. Don't listen to that. Don't go there. Don't do this. This is what you want to do. And the more you listen to the Spirit, the more change that you have that you see within your life, and the stronger you get spiritually. And all that's happening is you are transforming and conforming into the image of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And so that God's spiritual work can be manifested through you. Amen. So in order for this process to start, it takes you to repent, to call upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, that you can be saved, and for you to go and be baptized in the name of Jesus, whereby you may receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. So you can also go to our website and hit the salvation tab, and there are some instructions there to get this process started in your life. And you can also go towards the end of the video, whereas the Lord leading guides us in the opening of the gates to the kingdom, if you will. So without any further ado, we'll get right into our Bible study. Again, we'll be going into Judges chapter 10. God is the great and the holy eternal chef. The bread which God has prepared for us to break and receive is the bread of life, the word of life, the source of all life, which is the Lord Jesus Christ, who is also the Word of God. The Holy Spirit is the organizer. He has moved me to start a recording or to start this broadcast, and he has given you an invitation to come and sup, and you've received the invitation, and here you are joining us in this broadcast and learning. You've accepted the invitation to come and sup with the Father through Jesus Christ. Amen. My wife and myself, my wife being the editor, me being the broadcaster, if you will, our job is to serve. Amen. And then you receive, to God be the glory, in Jesus' name. Amen. So without any further ado, let's eat. This would be chapter 10 of Judges, beginning at verse 1. And after Abimelech, there arose to defend Israel Tola, the son of Puah, the son of Dodu, a man of Issachar. And he dwelt in Shamer in Mount Ephraim. So the scripture is talking about after Abimelech. And we've already read the in the last recording, the story of Abimelech here, being the son of I can't call him an illegitimate son, but being a son of Gideon. And of course, in our last lesson, we had an opportunity to learn about how Abimelech killed his brothers, his 70 brothers, so that he himself would always have the throne, if you will. So the scriptures pick up after his death, if you will. And he ruled over Israel for 3 years. And after him, scriptures briefly make mention here of Tola and the son of Pua. And I think there's no real military information concerning what battles had taken place during their time to judge. So scriptures we're not going to see here in verse 1 about any military confrontations during the time of their, I don't want to say during the time of their reign, but during the time of their judgeship, if you will. Verse 2, and he judged Israel 23 years and died and was buried in Shamar. And after him arose Jair, a Gileadite, and judged Israel 22 years. So here you got 23 years and 22 years. That's 45 years. And he had 30 sons that rode on 30 ass coats. And they had 30 cities, which are called Havoth Jair, unto this day, which are in the land of Gilead. And Jair died and was buried in Chemon. Now, and I believe the reason why the scriptures make mention of it is, it wants to show us the time which elapses. So you have a total of seemingly here about 45 years, 23, and what is this, 23, and then you have 22 years. So you got a total of 45 years total that these two had judged Israel. And then the scriptures is going to bring us into this next judge here. So beginning at verse 6, and the children of Israel, they did evil again in the sight of the Lord, and they served Balaam and Ashtoreth, the gods of Syria, and the gods of Zidon, and the gods of Moab, and the gods of the children of Ammon, and the gods of the Philistines, and they forsook the Lord and served him not. And so, when you forsake God, it's that you're no longer walking in his ordinance. Those things that you know that are pleasing to God, it's like you stop caring about his feelings and you go do what you want to do. Well, once you begin to come against God, or once you begin to forsake him, then ultimately you begin to serve other things. Men are created to serve. That's just the bottom line. And you're either going to serve yourself or you're going to serve the God that hath made you, which is the God of Isaac, the God of Israel. Or you're going to serve the God that's the one that the world has made to be overseer of them. You know, the enemy himself. You're either going to serve the God of Israel, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, or you're going to serve the God of this world, or you're going to serve yourself. But man, in some capacity, spiritually, is made to serve. And a lot of times when he's rebellious, what he does is he drinks and he brings in things within his temple because he's trying to fill that void there that only God can fill. And so when you're not serving God, then you give yourself away to the enemies that wants to occupy that open space and fill it with things that's going to constantly offend God, right? So the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the only wise, true God, he fills us with joy and contentment. We have the joy of our salvation. And we're not carried away with every doctrine. But once we begin to forsake God, all of a sudden we're tossed to and fro. And we're in everybody's religion. We're studying everything about false things, things that can't save us. And this is what happens when we walk away from God. It's almost like we're walking away from his protection and the commitment, the contentment and the peace that we got when we're walking with him. So look at all the gods that Israel begin to serve, the false gods. They begin to move closer towards the Gentiles, and they begin to learn the ways of the Gentiles, right? And they begin to not only learn their ways, but they begin to worship the way the Gentiles worship, the false gods. Amen? Going on with the scriptures here, verse 7. And the anger of the Lord was hot against Israel, and he sold them into the hands of the Philistines and into the hands of the children of Ammon. And that year they vexed and oppressed the children of Israel. This went on for 18 years. All the children of Israel that were on the other side of Jordan in the land of the Amorites, which is in Gilead. Moreover, the children of Ammon passed over Jordan to fight also against Judah and against Benjamin and against the house of Ephraim, so that Israel was sore distressed. So once Israel committed themselves to go a whoring, if you will, after other gods, it angered the Lord. And so his hand of protection was against them. And don't you know that when God is for you, that your enemies are at peace with you? They may not like you, but they don't try to run up on you, right? Well, once Israel walked away from God, or once they forsook God, it's like God's hand of protection came off them. And those that have been wanting to do them wrong, God let them have them. You're like, you've been wanting them? Go ahead, you know, and so they're the Philistines and the Ammonites, they came and they began to oppress Israel. And so this went on for 18 years. And then watch this. Not only did they get Israel that was on the side, on one side of the Jordan, and you got to remember, actually, let's go to Numbers chapter 32, verse 33. Numbers 32, verse 33. I want to cover a scripture here so you can see exactly who it was, which tribe was being oppressed. So Numbers 32, beginning at verse 33. And Moses gave unto them, even to the children of Gad and to the children of Reuben, and unto the half tribe of Manasseh, the son of Joseph, the kingdom of Sihon, the kingdom of the Amorites, and the kingdom of Og, king of Bashan, in the land with cities thereof in the coast, even the cities of the country round about. So again, this land that's being talked about, this is this land of Gilead. So you got the half tribe of Manasseh. You've got Gad and you got Reuben that has this land before they crossed over the Jordan to come into the land of Canaan. Before they crossed over, there was this land of Gilead. Israel ended up doing battle with the kings that governed that land, if you will. And they end up taking possession. Well, some years down the road or some decades down, or actually we're talking centuries, we're going to see some 300 years. Now, all of a sudden, you got the children of Ammon are wanting to go to battle with Israel. They begin to oppress Israel and the Philistines. And so they wasn't content with just going into the land of Gilead. They crossed over the Jordan, and they began to oppress the Benjamin and some of the tribes that were over on the other side, Ephraim and Judah. So again, when the Lord took his hand of protection off of Israel for their rebellion and how they forsook him, that allowed the enemies to come in. And once God takes his hand off of you, now you're in your enemy's hand, right? And so, again, the enemy wasn't content with just going after Israel on one side of the Jordan. Once they conquered one aspect of them, which was in the land of Gilead, they crossed over and conquered the Judah, Benjamin, and Ephraim. Amen? So going on with the word here, Verse 10, and the children of Israel, they begin to cry unto the Lord, saying that we have sinned against thee, both because we have forsaken our God and we have served Balaam. Now, this is some repentance here. The first step to repentance is acknowledging what's going on with you and the situation that you're in, understanding how you have gotten into the situation. Because what's the point of God getting you out if you don't know how you got in? You're just going to go right back into the same thing. So Israel, because their enemies begin to persecute them, it caused Israel to cry out to the Lord their God, who they forsook. And they acknowledged two things. They acknowledged that not only did we leave you, but we even had the audacity to go and serve other gods. We left you, and then we went against you by going for the other gods. But let me tell you something. And God loves them, and we'll read how God is not wanting to go and deliver them because of how they did him. When God turns us loose to get out of our way so that we can go and do those things that are not pleasing to him, when we make the decision that this is just what I'm going to do when that's it, God is a respectable God. He'll get back and let you go and do what you want to do because God knows one thing. As good as he is to us, when he gets out of our way and let us go get that thing that we put over him, once we get to it, the enemy is going to use that to try to take that opportunity to kill us over the course of time. And that kind of persecution that the enemy puts on us, it starts out feeling good and being lustful and thinking that this is the right thing and the right feelings. And when that thing began to torment you, you remember how good God was to you. You remember how you didn't have to go through these things. How now everything is coming out of the woodwork and it's cutting your legs off and everything else, you know, and incapacitating you spiritually. Well, these things, the reason why God seemingly to me, in my own opinion, it seems to me that the reason why God allows you to go and do what you want to do is because he knows that your relationship, and this is my opinion, you're going to be tormented so much so that you're going to end up having a prayer life like you never had before because you're going to try to get back into the kingdom. That persecution from you obtaining those things that God warned you against, that persecution and torment that comes with those things have the tendency to strengthen your prayer life, to purify you spiritually. It's like you being in a fiery furnace. And you have nothing left inside of you but to cry out to the Lord your God. Those things ultimately begin to put it, but it took a hard head for you to go and to discover what God had tried to warn you about through dreams and messages from other people and sermons and what have you. Hold your place there. I had the scripture, the Lord had given me the scripture during the preparation of the lesson. Let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 5, beginning at verse 1, and I want to show you something here. This kind of amens what I'm saying here. 1 Corinthians chapter 5, beginning at verse 1, and Paul is talking to the church of Corinth concerning some immoralities that was going on at the church there. Now look at what it says here. Well, again, this is 1 Corinthians chapter 5, beginning at verse 1. Paul says, it's reported commonly that, word keeps coming out concerning this matter. It's reported commonly that there is fornication among you, and such fornication that is not so much as named amongst the Gentiles. Paul is saying, man, I keep getting reports about some lewd and lascivious acts that are going on over there. And the stuff that I'm, the depth of what I'm hearing about, I ain't even heard the Gentiles being involved in this stuff, or people that don't know better, people that's not serving the God that we serve. Paul is saying that the stuff that I'm hearing that's coming in from this location, people that don't know God, I don't even hear them engaging in stuff like this. Y'all got them beat. Paul goes on to say, and he begins to define what's happening, that one should have his father's wife. So again, the son, stepson to his, you know, the father's wife, the father's son is now sleeping with the wife as well as the father, right? The son is sleeping with his father's wife as well as the father. And instead of them being grieved about it, what they're doing is they're high-fiving one another. They're like, what? Dude, you did that? Get out of here, right? You know, they're indulging in the celebration of this grievous, sinful act, right? So in verse 2, you are puffed up, or Paul is saying that you're proud about this. You're high-fiving one another. Paul is saying you are puffed up and have not rather mourned that he that have done this deed might be taken away from among you. For I verily, as absent in the body, but present in spirit, have judged already, as though that I was present, concerning him that have done this deed. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, when you are gathered together in my spirit with the power of our Lord Jesus Christ, that to deliver such a one unto Satan for the destruction of the flesh, that the spirit may be saved in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. So what Paul is saying here, and instead of y'all putting this person out because they know right from wrong, but they're choosing to adhere to what they want to do, and instead of y'all putting them out, you're high-fiving and celebrating because you're envious of what they're doing. Paul is saying, I judge this matter, and they need to be put out of that place of worship and let them go to the enemy, since they're doing the things that you would think that being seduced by the enemy that you would do. Let me put them out so that they can go to the enemy and that he can persecute them, which is what it's talking about, the destruction of the flesh. It's talking about being persecuted. And this persecution is going to move them towards repentance. This is what it's saying here, that to deliver such a one unto Satan for the destruction of the flesh, that the spirit may be saved in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. And that's what we're talking about here in the book of Judges, that God let them do what they want to do, follow and adhere to the acts of the Gentiles, go a whoring after their gods. God turned them over so that they can do what they want to do. And what happened is, it's like you turning them over to the enemy for the persecution of their flesh, or for the destruction of the flesh, so that they come crying back to God so that they can be saved. And this is what we see here in the book of Judges. Amen. So I'm not saying those of you that are lusting after something, go to it so that you can come running back to God. That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying that those very things that God has warned you about, he will turn you loose so you can adhere to it, but there is persecution that come to those things. God will get out of your way, since you're choosing those things over him. He'll let you have them, and you'll end up finding destruction. Before he lets you have it, he chastises you about wanting it. But even during the midst of his chastisement towards you, if you're still trying to adhere to that, even after he has chastised you for it, what more can he do? Get out of the way so you can go get to it. But the plan is, that's that very thing that you think is good, it's going to turn out to be bad, and it's going to break your teeth from biting into it, and you're going to come running back. Amen. So anyway, let's go on with the lesson here. Get out of the way of the word. So the children of Israel, they admitted, in verse 10, that not only did they leave him, but they went to go serve another God. In verse 11, and the Lord said unto the children of Israel, did I not deliver you from the Egyptians and from the Amorites, from the children of Ammon and from the Philistines, the Zidonians also? and the Amalekites and the Maonites, they did oppress you, and you cried to me, and I delivered you out of their hand. Yet ye have forsaken me, and you've gone and served other gods, wherefore I will deliver you no more. This is what you want. This is what you've got. Have you forgotten all that I've did for you? How did I deserve to have you walk away from me, where no matter who came against you, I never left you? I came in front of you so that they would fight me and you would end up getting the victory over what I did to them for wanting to come after you. And out of all that we've gone through, out of all of the deliverance, out of all of the things that I have brought you through and never left you, you want to leave me. And not only do you want to leave me, but you want to leave me from those that are trying to kill you. And God is saying, I'm not going to deliver you any longer. It is what it is, right? Verse 14, go and cry unto the gods which you have chosen, and let them deliver you in the time of your tribulation. And the children of Israel said unto the Lord, and I love this, because they wasn't taking no for an answer. When you've been persecuted and tormented and beaten and whooped and you know, made a fool out of, and you walking in shame, you're just not taking a no. You're not taking no for an answer when it comes to your deliverance. It's just, you know, and I like what's going on here. Here's verse 15. And the children of Israel said unto the Lord, we have sinned. You're right, God. You're right. Those things that you've done for us and how we've walked away from you, you're right. And you didn't deserve to have us do that to you. Do thou unto us whatsoever seemeth good unto thee. However, deliver us only, we pray thee, this day. If it's in your heart to punish us for leaving you, so be it. But in the process of you coming after us for what we've done, just deliver us. And not only deliver us, but deliver us this day. For 18 years, we had to deal with their torment and their oppression for 18 years. We much rather turn back to you and let your hand be against us, but that your heart be for us, right? They wasn't taking no for an answer. And watch this. They're bringing forth in this verse, we're going to see that they brought forth fruits of repentance, right? Fruits worthy of repentance. So here's verse 16. This is a down payment on their sincerity to God and their request for his deliverance. They put away the strange gods from among them, and they served the Lord. And his soul was grieved for the misery of Israel. So you can't go to God and be like, can you give me your heart? Because the enemy's hand the enemy's hand would have to be away from us if your heart is covering us. If you be for us, then who can be against us? And so they was like, look, not only are we calling on you, but we're renouncing those various things that we left you for, and those sinful things that we took part in. We are renouncing all that, and even the memory of any of those things within our premises, within our dwellings. We are getting rid of all of it. We don't even want it in our house. And God looked upon them and looked on the things that they did and for him, you know, towards him to come back into his bosom, if you will. And he was grieved, you know, from the oppression that you know, that the enemy had came against him with, you know, the heat. God was grieved. Amen. And it changed his heart concerning not being involved in their deliverance. It moved him so that it changed his heart, because he loves it. You think about your own children. And we do things because we love our children. And sometimes the hardest thing to do after they've been so rebellious is to let them go, so that they can discover what it's been that you've been trying to tell and teach them. And the hardest thing to do is to let them go and do those various things that you've warned them against. and to know and then to try to make sure that your heart is in the right place if they so forth come back and say, Mom, Dad, I was wrong. I dropped the ball, and you've tried to tell me, you've tried to show me, and you tried to warn me, and I didn't listen. And now look at what I've lost. Look at what I've gone through because of that. Just want to come to you and let you know that I'm sorry and to tell you that you was right and I was wrong. And I just want to be back with you. Not only to be safe, but to have a relationship again. I miss that because I let these things get in the midst of it. There's somebody that been wanting to tell their mom or their dad that they've been sorry and that they've been right. You can see the lesson here with Israel. Amen. And look what it did. It moved God to repent towards that which he was, you know, that which he said. He said that he wasn't going to help them, but look at what's going to happen here. So, verse 17, so the children of Ammon were gathered together, and they encamped in Gilead. And the children of Israel, they assembled themselves together, and they encamped in Mizpah. And the people and the princes of Gilead said one to another, what man is he that will begin to fight against the children of Ammon? And he shall be head over all the inhabitants of Gilead. So, after the children of Israel cried out to the Lord our God about making sure that he was with them and that he didn't cast them out, that they could come back to him, they began to stand up. They was like, okay, either God is with us or he's not going to be with us, but we're going to stand against our oppressors and see what's going to happen. And so they begin to cry out, who's among us that's brave and that's capable of leading us in this battle against the children of Ammon? So that's going to take care of chapter 10. We'll go right into chapter 11 to learn about Jephthah. So chapter 11 of Judges, verse 1. Now Jephthah the Gileadite was a mighty man of valor, and he was the son of a harlot, and Gilead begot Jephthah. So one would assume that the father of the Gileadites, if you will, that this was his son, one of his sons here. And Gilead's wife bare him sons, and his wife's sons grew up, and they thrust out Jephthah, and said unto him, thou shalt not inherit in our father's house, for thou art the son of a strange woman. So Gilead's sons that he had by his wife, unfortunately he had a child that was not by his wife, but by a prostitute or by a harlot. And as the children gotten older, Jephthah became the outcast. Because they didn't have the same mother, and the fact that his mother was a prostitute. And so they didn't want him, the brothers didn't want this brother by the prostitute, whose mom was a prostitute, they didn't want him coming into any part of the inheritance, you know, that they were to come into. So they expelled him from their father's house, if you will. And the thing about it is, he was a mighty man, as the scriptures start talking here in verse 1. He was known because he was good when it comes to battles. He was a mighty man of valor. I mean, he was just gifted in the area of one would think, you know, in confrontation as the scripture said, mighty man of valor. So he was gifted in this area here. However, because of his mother's background, he was not wanted. He was put away. He was cast out because of what is, you know, where he has come from. No fault of his own. So verse 3. Now, before we go into verse 3, let's read a little bit. Let's talk a little bit about Jephthah, because the New Testament mentions him in the book of Hebrews. So let's go into Hebrews chapter 11. Let's see what we want to reference. Hebrews chapter 11, beginning at verse 23, and it's talking about faith. And it's going to, one of the things that I, one of the reasons why I believe that it's going to mention Jephthah in the book of Hebrews is because this is a man that, again, was cast out because he didn't come from a home of purity, if you will. His mom, because of his mother's lifestyle, he was cast out, you know, as though he was not good for nothing. But the Lord, as we're going to read about, the Lord is still going to use somebody, regardless of where they come from, regardless of how their family was, regardless of who they hang around. If God causes you to be called, so for his glory and his purposes, then God has chosen you to rise above that which you allow man to put you down to. Huh? Watch this. And the Lord will make your enemies your footstool all day long for the sake of his glory. And so much so that this person in the Old Testament is written about in the New Testament. So here we are in Hebrews chapter 11, beginning at verse 23, and it's talking about faith, right? So Hebrews chapter 11, verse 23. By faith, Moses, when he was born, was hid 3 months of his parents because they saw he was a proper child. They knew that there was something about him, and they were not afraid of the king's commandment. And back then, the king commanded that the kids, all sons, I think under the age of, all boys that were born that were under the age of 2, if I remember right, were to be slain. By faith, in verse 24, Moses, when he was come to years, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season, esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches, than the treasures in Egypt. For he had respect unto the recompense of the reward. By faith he forsook Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king, for he endured as seeing him who is invisible. Through faith he kept the Passover and the sprinkling of blood, lest he that destroyed the firstborn should touch them. By faith they passed through the Red Sea as by dry land, which the Egyptians saying to do were drowned, or they tried to do the same thing that they seen the children of Israel do, and they end up drowning. By faith, the walls of Jericho fell down after they were encompassed about 7 days. By faith, the harlot Rahab perished not with them that believed not, when she had received the spies with peace. And what more shall I say? For the time would fail me to tell of Gideon, of Barak, and of Samson, and of Jephthah, of David also, and Samuel, and of the prophets, who through faith subdued kingdoms, wrought righteousness, obtained promises, stopped the mouths of lions, quenched the violence of fire, escaped the edge of the sword, out of weakness were made strong, wax valiant in fight, turn to fight the armies of the aliens or the armies of the invaders. Amen. So again, Jephthah is briefly mentioned here in the New Testament as being used for the sake of God's glory and all by faith. Amen. Now going back to chapter 11 of Judges, verses 4. So it came to pass that in the process of time that the children of Ammon made war against Israel. And it was so that when the children of Ammon made war against Israel, that the elders of Gilead, they went out to fetch Jephthah out of the land of Tob. And again, Jephthah, they knew who they were looking for because this man's reputation preceded him. Remember, verse 1 of chapter 11 talks about how he was a mighty man of valor. So they needed somebody that can help them take this stand against the children of Israel, a military captain that will lead them into victory. Amen. So verse 5, and it was so that when the children of Ammon made war against the children of Israel, the elders of Gilead went out to fetch Jephthah. And they said unto Jephthah, come and be our captain that we may fight with the children of Ammon. And Jephthah said unto the elders of Gilead, did not ye hate me and expel me out of my father's house? And why are you come to me now when you are in distress? And the elders of Gilead said unto Jephthah, therefore we turn again to thee now, that thou mayest go with us and fight against the children of Ammon and be our heads over all the inhabitants of Gilead. Look, yeah, we know. Yeah, you're right. When your brothers put you out, we did. You know, we not only did they put you out of your father's house, but we put you out of the land as well. Yeah, we was wrong. However, here's what we're willing to do. If you would come back and help us out and fight with us, we'll make you captain, and you'll be over all the inhabitants of the land of Gilead. Okay? Verse 9, and Jephthah said unto the elders of Gilead, so what you're saying is, if you bring me home again to fight against the children of Ammon, and the Lord deliver them before me, I shall be your head? Are we on the same page? Is this what you're saying to me? And the elders of Gilead said unto Jephthah, the Lord be witness between us, if we do not so according to thy words. Then Jephthah went with the elders of Gilead, and the people made him head and captain over them. And Jephthah uttered all his words before the Lord in Mizpah. So, again, I guess Jephthah is saying here that okay, y'all want me to come, and y'all saying that if I come and fight with you, and then we get military victory over our oppressors, then as recompense for me, you will let me be judge over you. You'll let me reign over all the house of Gilead, if you will, all the land of Gilead, all the inhabitants. And they said, yes. So he committed to them to do this in the sight of the Lord our God. Amen. Verse 12, so Jephthah sent messengers unto the king of the children of Ammon. And this is what he was saying. What hast thou to do with me that thou art come out against me to fight in my land? And the king of the children of Ammon answered unto the messengers of Jephthah, because Israel took away my land when they came up out of Egypt, from Arnon even unto Jabbok and unto Jordan. Now, therefore, restore those lands again peaceably. And Jephthah sent messengers against the king of the children of Ammon and said unto them, thus said Jephthah, Israel took not away the land of Moab, nor the land of the children of Ammon. But when Israel came up from Egypt and walked through the wilderness unto the Red Sea and came to Kadesh, then Israel sent messengers unto the king of Edom, saying, let me, I pray thee, pass through thy land. But the king of Edom would not hearken thereunto, and in like manner they sent unto the king of Moab, but he would not consent as well, and Israel abode in Kadesh. So what's going on here is, as Jephthah is the military captain for the children of Israel, he reached out to the head of Ammon, and he's saying, what is this that you're coming up against us? And so the response from the king of Ammon, if you will, or whoever the head of Ammon was, the response was, the reason why we are here and willing to do battle with you is because when you first came out of Egypt and came through, you took all of our lands from us. And so if you don't want to have this confrontation right now, then you need to restore all the land that you've taken from us during your journey over here to Canaan. Jephthah responded by saying, no, you've got it all wrong. We didn't just take your land. That's not what happened. When we were coming through and came over to Kadesh, in order for us to go any further beyond Kadesh, we needed to get permission from the kings of the territories who we would have to pass through to get to Canaan. And as we sent messengers out to these kings, all of them refused us safe passage through their land so that we can get to Kadesh. It had nothing to do with us just going forth to conquer and take their territory. It wasn't on the agenda to go to battle with any of them. That's why we sent messengers to go and gain permission that we may have safe passage through their territories. Verse 17, then Israel sent messages unto the king of Edom, saying, let me pass, let me, I pray thee, pass through thy land. But the king of Edom would not hearken thereunto. And in like manner, they sent unto the king of Moab, but he would not consent. So Israel abode in Kadesh. Then they went along through the wilderness and compassed the land of Edom and the land of Moab and came by the east side of the land of Moab and pitched on the other side of Arnon, but came not within the borders of Moab, for Arnon was the border of Moab. And Israel sent messengers unto Sihon, king of the Amorites, the king of Heshbon. And Israel said unto them, let us pass, we pray thee, through the land into my place. So again, they're saying that because these kings denied us passage, we end up having to detour and go carefully around, and we ended up where they ended up over here by Heshbon, king of Heshbon. They ended up over there. And so in order to get through that, they sent word out to King Sihon, the king of Heshbon, which is the land of the giants, and asked for safe passage that they may pass through to get to their territory. But Sihon, in verse 20, trusted not Israel to pass through his coast. But Sihon gathered all his people together and pitched in Jahaz and fought against Israel. And the Lord God of Israel delivered Sihon and all of his people into the hand of Israel, and they smote them. So Israel possessed all the land of the Amorites and the inhabitants of that country. And they possessed all the coast of the Amorites, from Arnon even unto Jabbok, and from the wilderness even unto Jordan. So now the Lord God of Israel has dispossessed the Amorites from before his people Israel, and shouldest thou possess it? So ultimately, your rift is not with us. Your rift is with the God whom we serve. He the one that has taken your land and given it to us. Should we give it back to you? That's what he's saying here, right? So verse 24, wilt not thou possess that which Chemosh, thy God, giveth thee to possess? So the children of Ammon, they serve the false god of Chemosh. And so what Japheth says, if your God gave you land to possess that you've taken from us, would you give that land back to us if we ask for it? So whoever the Lord our God shall drive off from before us, them will we possess. You know? Verse 25. And now art thou anything better than Balak, the son of Zippor, king of Moab? Did he ever strive against Israel? Or did he ever fight against them? So Jephthah was, it's pretty good what Jephthah is saying. This, you can tell the spirit of the Lord is, you know, the man is gifted. The Lord has put the spirit on him. Jephthah is saying, now, before you come on and contend with us, let's use Balak as an example. Balak became a casualty of this whole thing too. You got Balak as an example. How did it fare for him ultimately, right? If it didn't fare for him any better, what make you think that you're going to prevail? If it didn't prevail for Sihon, what make you think that you're going to prevail any better? Huh? You're just stalling out the inevitable, right? Verse 26. While Israel dwelt in Heshbon and her towns, and in Arnon and her towns, and in all the cities that be along the side of the coast of Arnon, they dwelt there 300 years. Why therefore did ye not recover them within that time? Because you couldn't. Because God was God before Israel. There was no way that they could, once God took the land from them and gave it to Israel, there was no way they could get the land back. And if they couldn't get it back then, what make them think they're going to get it back now, right? This is what he's saying. Wherefore, I've not sinned against thee, but thou doest wrong to war against me. The Lord, the judge, be judged this day between the children of Israel and the children of Ammon. Howbeit, the king of the children of Ammon hearkened not unto the words of Japheth, which he sent him. Verse 29. Then the Spirit of the Lord came upon Jephthah, and he passed over Gilead and Manasseh, and passed over Mizpah of Gilead, and from Mizpah of Gilead he passed over unto the children of Ammon. So he, once the Spirit of the Lord fell upon Jephthah, he went marching through these territories so that he can bring the fight to Ammon. And what's interesting here is, look at his background. What did he do to be born into this situation? He didn't do anything. That's just not anything that he did. But he was an outcast because of the family that he has come from. Because of what his mom did. But whoever the Lord chooses, God chooses them before they're born, because God knows what's going to happen. And it doesn't matter who you're with, what you're doing, God will call you. And when he calls you, he expects you to answer the call. Put those things down, move those things out of your life so that God can have all of you that he's calling for, and so that you can do some great things for and on his behalf for the sake of his glory. And this is really one of the things that reaches out, that touches me about this story here, is when he was casted out, how they sought him. Because they knew how he was. And if they thought he would have said no, they wouldn't have ever sought him out to begin with. But they knew what kind of person he was, and they knew how he was. And they sought him out after they did him wrong. And so it's God's glory all day long with this. And it's just a beautiful, beautiful touching thing here. So anyway, so the Spirit of the Lord falls upon him. And he go marching through these territories. He go marching through Gilead, through Manasseh, and he passed over Mizpah of Gilead. And from Mizpah of Gilead, he passed over unto the children of Arnon. So they didn't have to come to Ammon, the children of Ammon. They didn't have to come to him. He took the battle to them, right? And Jephthah vowed a vow unto the Lord and said, if thou shalt without fail deliver the children of Ammon into my hand, then it shall be that whosoever cometh forth out of the doors of my house to meet me, when I return in peace from the children of Ammon, shall surely be the Lord's hand, shall surely be the Lord's, and I will offer it for a burnt offering. So he said, Lord, if you will, this is why we let our yeas be yeas and our nays be nays. It's either yes, yes, or no, no. We don't make promises that we can't keep. And so what Jephthah is saying here is, Lord, if you would allow this victory, if you would deliver them into our hands, then when I return to my home, which I haven't been for so long, when I return back to my home, the first thing that comes through my door, I'm going to give that to you, as a burnt offering, as a sacrifice, as a commitment to you. I'm going to give that to you, Lord. So verse 32. So Jephthah passed over unto the children of Ammon to fight against them, and the Lord delivered them into his hands. And he smote them from Arnon, from Aroer, even till the end of Minnith, even 20 cities, unto the plain of the vineyards, with a great slaughter. Thus the children of Ammon were subdued before the children of Israel. And Jephthah came to Mizpah unto his house. And behold, his daughter came out to meet him with tabrels or tabarines or something to that extent, and with dances. And she was his only child. Beside her, he had neither son nor daughter. So when he returned home after the great slaughter, lo and behold, and you can imagine he probably hadn't seen his daughter in so long because he was expelled from the land of Gilead. And so having to return home, lo and behold, the first thing that comes out of the house is his only child. It's his daughter. And of course, he made this vow saying that whatever comes through my door when I come back into the land, whatever comes through that door, Lord, that's going to be yours. That's going to be a dedication to you. And lo and behold, it's his only daughter. And it came to pass, verse 35, that when he saw her, that he rent his clothes. And he said, alas, my daughter, thou hast brought me very low. Thou art one of them that troubled me. For I have opened my mouth unto the Lord, and I can't take it back. I cannot go back. And she said unto him, my father, if thou hast opened thine mouth unto the Lord, do to me according to that which has proceeded out of thine mouth. For as much as the Lord had taken vengeance for thee of thine enemies, even of the children of Ammon. She said unto her father, let this thing be done for me. Let this thing be done for me. Let me alone 2 months that I may go up and down the mountains and bewail or lament my virginity, I and my fellows or I and my companions. And he said, go. And he sent her away for 2 months. And when she went, he sent her away for 2 months. And she went with her companions and bewailed her virginity unto the mountains. And it came to pass that at the end of 2 months that she returned unto her father, who did with her according to his vow which he had vowed. And she knew no man. And it was with the custom, as it was with the custom of in Israel, that the daughters of Israel the daughters of Israel went yearly to lament the daughter of Jephthah, the Gileadite, 4 days in a year. Now, some people debate that she was given as a living, as a burnt sacrifice, you know, killed and delivered up. I don't get that from this when I read, because it talks about her virginity, and it said that she knew no man. I'm believing that all of her life, because of the vow that the father made concerning her, that she never knew a man, that the rest of her days were spent out in a commitment towards God and in service towards him, that she was never to be given to a man because she was given to God himself. Again, some scholars would debate the fact that because of his vow, he actually had to kill her and deliver her up. I don't read that here. What I actually get from this is, again, that as the scripture says, she never knew a man, and when she went to go be well, she went to go lament her virginity. And to me, what I get out of that is that she couldn't allow herself to be with any man, which is what she, you know, some women believe that their purpose for is to be a wife. A man, as the scripture said, you know, that they can not only be a wife, but be a help, that's meet to a man. And if you take, you know, her purpose is taken away from her concerning that. And so, and I'll probably make it too much out of it, so let me quit while I'm ahead. But that's what I get out of this. I don't get that he killed her. I believe, again, that she was set aside for service unto God. She was never given to a man because she was given over to the Lord our God. Amen. So, anyway, let's go and read. That'll do for our Bible study concerning Judges 10 and 11. And Lord willing, in another recording, we'll come back to that for chapter 12. Amen. In the meantime, let's go over to John, the Gospel of John, chapter 14, beginning at verse 1. The Gospel of John, chapter 14, beginning at verse 1. And here's Jesus speaking to his disciples. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. Now, Jesus is, again, speaking to his disciples, also speaking to us. And he starts off by saying, let not your hearts be troubled, because I have to go away. But me going away is a good thing, because I'm going to prepare a place for you so that where he is, we can be there with him. Now, understand that if wherever Jesus is going, if he's preparing a place for us, he's not expecting us to go there as we are. That means that we have to begin to transition from who we was to who we will be in him. We have to learn how to start to trust him. This is why he's saying, let not your hearts be troubled. If you believe in God, believe also in him. We have to learn to trust him and to give ourselves over to him so that he can prepare us to receive the place that he has prepared for us individually and collectively. If I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. And whither I go, ye know, and the way you know. So Jesus is saying here that as I'm going to prepare a place, when the time is right and things are ready, then I'm going to come and I'm going to receive you. Now, again, we can't just come off from the dance floor and go up into the kingdom. There has to be a transition for us to be received by him. We have to be willing to submit ourselves for him and to him so that through the Holy Spirit, he can make us formidable brides of Christ, brides for him, being the bridegroom, and that we can be his bride. He's coming back for his bride. So we can't be calling him, we can't be engaged to the Lord Jesus Christ, who is going to get a home for us. And folks, those of you that are looking to get married, amen for that. But look, the husband goes to make the place, and then he comes back for his bride, right? You know, after he establishes himself, you know, and has a place for his bride, he come back for his bride. That's what a man does, right? But in the meantime, while the bride is being betrothed, she can't be out here messing around and flirting around with those that mean her no good. Because she is chosen to be the bride, there is a way that she has to conduct herself. She has to conduct herself like a bride in transition to become a wife. She has to go through this. She has to go through this transformation. It's the same thing with us being the bride of Christ. He has chosen and promised to marry us, placed a ring on a finger, and say, "When the time is right, I'm going to come back for you." Now we, being because we have accepted the invitation to be a bride to the bridegroom, we're also accepting the fact that we're learning how to be who we're supposed to be in Jesus Christ. But if you keep putting your will before his will, what would make him want to come back and receive you when you're not allowing him to make you this bride without spot and wrinkle, if you will? Now is the time for you to submit to him, because he's trying, just like a bride transitions from a bride to one that's betrothed to the one that's married, one that's engaged to one that's married, the bride to the wife, if you will. Making that transition, we have to make that transition. And it starts when we say, "I do" to him. When we say, I do, I give you my life. So then the transformation has to start, right? So we have to be willing to come out of this world and let those things go. Let those things be removed away from us so that we can focus on the place that he is preparing for us within the kingdom. Verse 5, Thomas saith unto him, "Lord, we know not whether thou goest, and how can we know the way?" Jesus said unto him, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. You don't get no simpler text than that. The only way that we can have this relationship with God, the only way that we can have access with God the Father, is that we receive Jesus Christ as Lord, the only begotten Son of God, Jesus Christ. We have to go through the Son to have the relationship with the Father. If we can't adhere to the Son, if we reject the Son, then we reject the Father. You can't bypass Jesus and have the relationship with God. That's not the way God set it up now. He set it up to where in order to have access to Him, you have to have access to Jesus the Christ. You have to go through the Son to have the Father. Amen. The Father is the one paying for the wedding. So if He's the one paying for it, and if He's the one that's making sure this thing happened, we have to receive who He placed in our life so that we can make it, so that God Himself can be our Father and we can be His sons and daughters. Amen. So Jesus says that He is the way, He is the truth, and He is the life. Now, He is the only way. We just got done talking about that. He is the truth. Everything else outside of that is a lie. If they try to tell you it don't take all that, if they try to tell you that there is another way, that is a lie. Jesus is the truth. He is this word of God. He is every promise that is fulfilled. He is the promises of God being yea and amen. Jesus is the truth. And then watch this. He is the life. That eternal life that God is offering, the eternal life, the gift of this life that God is offering through His Son, Jesus Christ. Jesus is not only preparing a place for us, but He is also preparing a life, an eternal life for us. If we will receive it, it's up to us to receive it. But the opposite of these things is a broad and a confused way. No direction. If Jesus is the way, what is the opposite of that? There is no true distinguishable way. There's this running to and fro. And if Jesus is the truth, outside of Jesus, if you have not received Him, then you've been living by lies. And if He is the life, if you haven't received Him, then you've been living and on the pathway of death. If you, verse 7, if you have known me, you should have known my Father also, and from henceforth you know Him, and you have seen Him. Philip said unto him, Lord, show us the Father, as it sufficeth us. Jesus saith unto him, Have I been so long time with you, and yet hast thou not known me, Philip? He that hath seen me have seen the Father. And how sayest thou then, show us the Father? Believest thou not that I am in the Father and the Father in me? The words that I speak not for myself, but the Father that dwelleth in me, He doeth the work. So Jesus is saying that I'm in my Father and my Father is in me. My Father and I, we are one. We are one together and we're on the same page. And It's the Father that's extending an invitation to you to come and join us. God wants this. God wants you. It don't matter where you've come from. It don't matter what you've been doing. It don't matter who you've been doing it with. But He wants to be with you. And it don't matter in what condition you come to Him. You can be damaged goods. But His Son is in charge of you now. And God is going to... God wants to marry you to His Son so that His Son can conform you to the ways of the Father, which is of righteousness and of truth and full of life. You have to decide for yourself how real this thing is and if you want to commit to it. Because if you want to commit to it, then you have to renounce these things that you're out here doing. Drugs and fornication, adultery, idol worship, so many things, murder and envies and covetousness, all these things that has pulled you away and brought you into despair and brought you into death, bringing you down a road of death, a loss, a bondage, seclusion, all these things that has taken away an abundant life. God wants to remove you from that. But he's a respectable God. He's not going to stand in your way. Romans 10 and 9. Let's go there real quick. Romans 10 and 9. Look at what this says here. That if thou shalt confess with thine mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thine heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. Now, what is this scripture talking about? God knew before he allowed his son to be born into this world that men would need some help. And that of our own, being able to sacrifice bulls and rams and doves, that it wouldn't be enough to atone for our sins. As soon as we do those, as soon as we offer those things as sacrifices to atone for our sins, we're right back in the hot seat again. So God had devised a plan. He says, I'll let my son become a sacrificial lamb, and I will let them deliver him, that he would lay down his life for them, and that the shedding of my son's blood will be enough to atone for their sins forever. So what God did is he allowed his son to be born into this world as a baby. And at the age of around 30 years old, Jesus started the ministry that God purposed him for. And ultimately, around the age of 33, Jesus laid down his life and he allowed men to capture him. And he allowed them to hang him on a cross. And he allowed them to pierce him so that his blood may be shed. And the shedding of his blood is what atones for our sins today. And after 3 days and three nights of his death, God raised Jesus up, not in just spirit form, but also in fleshly form. God raised Jesus from the dead, brought him back to life. And after 40 days of that resurrection, God ascended Jesus up into heaven. Jesus came to earth in spirit form, being born from the womb of a woman, leaving his holy habitat, if you will, leaving his place with his father as the spirit, and then was born into this world as a man, as a little boy, and became a man. And now he rules on his father's right-hand side in heaven as a man. He never returned to that spirit form that he had with his father. He returned in the fleshly form as a man. And let me tell you the beauty of that, because those things that you go through, those things that are hard for you to lay to the side and you need help with, the one that has been a man and know exactly what it is that you've gone through is Jesus Christ. And so he is able to intercede because he is in present form in heaven as a man. And he is able to let the Father know that they need a little grace, a little mercy, and he intercedes for us because he knows what we've gone through, because the same temptations that were upon you, they were upon him as well. Amen. But he was without sin. And because he was without sin, his blood is enough to atone for your sins. So that's what the scripture is saying, that God has raised him from the dead, that if thou shalt confess with thine mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thine heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. If you receive that gospel that I just presented to you, if you believe it within your heart and you believe that Jesus is the only way, then because of your belief, you will be saved. Amen. Verse 10, for with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Verse 12, for there is no difference between the the Jew or the Greek. For the same Lord over all is rich unto all that call upon him. Verse 13, for whomsoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Now, the last few scriptures that we shall read shall be in Acts chapter 2, verse 36. And this is Peter that's addressing the Gentiles that came out to hear the disciples speak. So Acts 2, verse 36. Therefore, let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God had made that same Jesus whom you've crucified, both Lord and Christ. Remember, we read in the Gospel of John, Jesus says, I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. No man come unto the Father except through Jesus. Well, Peter just comes back and affirms that. Let the house of Israel know assuredly that God had made that same Jesus whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ. He made Jesus to be the way for us. Amen. Verse 37. Now, when they heard this, those that were in attendance, when they heard this, they were pricked, or they were convicted in their heart. And they said unto Peter and to the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? Or Peter and everyone else, what can we do to be saved? And here's Peter's response. Peter said in verse 38, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. So repent means to not only have a change of mind, but have a change of heart concerning that. If I tell you that, if we know that this is wrong, and we keep messing with this anyway, and the only reason you stopped doing it is because the law said that you needed to stop, but you don't see any wrong with this, then it won't be long before you go back to it, because you can't see anything wrong with this. But if you start to understand, and we're talking hypothetically, if you start to understand that this is wrong, that it's not just about the law saying it's wrong, but you know for sure that this is wrong, and you feel it in your heart that this is not right, you turn away from that. You're not looking to come back to it because you have an understanding that that's wrong, and I'm not trying to get down with that. That's what repentance is. If somebody tell you something is wrong and you don't agree and you just take their word for it, it won't be long before you go back and try to exploit and try to find a reason how you can obtain that which you're told that you can't have. But if you actually look at it and you see that it's wrong and you have an understanding of why it's wrong, that's where the Spirit of God comes in at. The Spirit of God helps you to understand why those things are wrong and what is the results of you engaging or obtaining those things that are no good for you, right? So if you repent, true repentance is not only having a change of mind, but a change of heart concerning those things. It's walking away from them and moving away from it and then going and being baptized. And it says that if you follow through, if you repent, and if you go and get baptized in the name of Jesus Christ, then you become a recipient of receiving the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit is important because it is the Holy Spirit's job that makes you into this perfect bride, if you will, for Christ Jesus. It's the Holy Spirit irons out the spots, irons out the wrinkles, and cleans the spots that are on our gowns, if you will. The Holy Spirit conforms us to understand better how the works of God works with our faith. The Holy Spirit help us to receive and to understand and to strengthen us, to get us into the prayer closet. And the spiritual things of God, the Holy Spirit translates for us so that we can understand and that we are empowered by those things that we've received from God. Amen. So it's very, very, very important that you receive the Holy Ghost. And if you get baptized in the name of Jesus, the scriptures tells you that you'll receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Man, so let us pray with you. Eternal God, we bless you, we thank you, we praise you because you're worthy to be praised, you're worthy to be worshiped, you're worthy to be served, you're worthy to be feared. Father, you have kept us when we didn't know you, when we never thought about you, you were thinking about us and you kept us. Now, Father, you have opened up eyes, you have softened hearts, and you have given strength to legs for people who's sat and ran away from you. Now they're running towards you because of your goodness and your kindness. Father, help them to come into your holy kingdom and let things around them line up with them so that it don't be a hindrance to them as they serve you. Bring to life and to understanding their gifts and callings. Those that have run into your kingdom seeking after your face. Those that have received Jesus Christ as not only Lord, but Savior. Father, help them. Father, help them to become strong in you. Help them to take up the charge for which you purposed them for. Place a hedge of protection so that they would understand and that they would see the glory of God and that it would testify that no weapon formed against them shall prosper. Father, the work that you have given us to do for this day, Lord, we have done that which you have asked. Now, Lord, be ye glorified. Be ye magnified in the sight of all men. And Jesus, reign and rule in everyone's life, that every head bow, every tongue confess, every knee bows and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Father, thank you for placing us on the path of salvation, for allowing your Son to have us as the bride and the body of Christ. We pray for those that have returned to you and those that have come to you for the first time. Father, keep them in your ways. Keep them away from evil and temptation. And let them grow in the righteousness of Jesus Christ. In all joy, in all truth, and in all life. To God be the glory, now and forevermore, in Jesus' name. Amen, amen, and hallelujah, God, in Jesus' name. Folks, we had a wonderful, wonderful time. Thank you for allowing us to be a part of your Bible study here at the beginning of 2016. We love you. Thank you for your prayers. Thank you for remembering us in your giving towards the kingdom of God. We love you, and we look forward to supping with you again. God bless you. Amen.
This has been a United Body of Christ Church video production. You can visit our website at www.ubcchurch.org.